everybody, and welcome. On November 19th, SpaceX performed the sixth test flight for Starship, and depending on whether or not you know what you're talking about, the mission was a success or a failure. We'll talk about that a little bit later. Just like with the previous test, the Super Heavy booster was supposed to be caught again by the tower arms. But this time, something didn't go as planned.
Booster offshore divert.
Nevertheless, SpaceX was able to collect a huge amount of valuable data, and there were a lot of other important tests that were performed. One of them, in my opinion, the most important of them all, more important than the tower catch. Before we go into that, if all things space and also the topic of space simulation games interests you, please subscribe to this channel, and if you enjoy what you're seeing, leave a like while you're visiting. It really helps the channel out. But now, let's talk about 6 milestones during Starship's Flight Test 6. And the first one is catch denied. A lot of people were waiting to see the spectacle of the launch tower arms catching the booster for the second time. However, at around 4 minutes after launch, we could hear the call out booster offshore divert.
Booster offshore divert.
This happened during the boost back burn phase of the flight and meant that the booster would not land back at Starbase, but would perform a soft splashdown in the Gulf of Mexico. And we were able to see this from multiple angles, in the official SpaceX livestream and also in the streams by NASA Spaceflight and Everyday Astronaut. While SpaceX cut away before the booster exploded after toppling over, the other streamers kept rolling and were able to bring us some juicy explosion images. We could also see on Everyday Astronaut's stream that the remaining structure of the booster was floating for quite some time. Maybe this could warrant a salvage operation. I mean, there was enough left over to at least consider it. But what caused SpaceX to abort the catch attempt? In order for the catch maneuver to be carried out, systems on both booster and tower need to give the green light. However, SpaceX explained after the mission on their website that the tower systems triggered the catch attempt abort. Which of the many systems was the cause is at time of recording unknown. But there is speculation that a damaged communications tower on top of the structure might have something to do with it. During launch, there was too much smoke in the air to make out what had happened to the tower. But maybe we will find out in the next couple of days. While we didn't see those crazy catch images again, there was something else that was totally bananas. It is custom in launch vehicle testing to have some dummy payload or mass simulator on board. SpaceX have a tradition to use unusual items for this. To test Falcon Heavy, they put a Tesla Roadster into the payload fairing and sent it onto an interplanetary trajectory. For Starship Flight 6, despite Starship's massive claimed payload capacity of more than 100 tons to low Earth orbit, the payload was tiny, a banana for scale. It was strung up inside the payload section of the vehicle and held its own during ascent and even orbital maneuvers. While still intact in space, it did look a bit more bloated than while waiting for launch, but that could also be because it was rotated compared to the other shot. Unfortunately, SpaceX refused to show live images of the banana during re-entry. Did it survive the rigors of atmospheric heating, or was it fried? The public has a right to know. On a serious note, thermal insulation is going to be an important feature when SpaceX wants to return humans back to Earth aboard Starship. So finding out how that banana held up would in fact be valuable data. Speaking of returning to Earth, this leads us to our next item. Raptor Relight. This was, at least in my opinion, the most important aspect of Test Flight 6. So far, SpaceX was able to demonstrate that the Raptor engines can launch something and land something, but they haven't been able to show relighting the engine while in space when the vehicle is in microgravity. Shortly before re-entry, one of the 6 engines on Starship, an atmospheric variant, was lit for a very short period. Things appeared to work just fine, as there were positive callouts from mission control. Why is this important? So far, Starship was merely tested on a suborbital trajectory, meaning it would come back down to Earth due to physics alone. If SpaceX wants to have a vehicle that can perform a stable orbit and then land at any given time not dictated by orbital mechanics, they need to demonstrate that they can decelerate the vehicle enough to make it re-enter the atmosphere at a planned time and location. Also, Starship is supposed to carry humans and cargo to the moon and later to Mars. Current ambitious timelines speak of first test flights to Mars in 2026 already. For this to work, the Raptor engines need to relight in orbit to perform an interplanetary transfer burn to get it to the red planet. Roughly 38 minutes into the flight, SpaceX proved that Starship and the Raptor engine are indeed capable of doing this. Another important thing when returning from space is surviving atmospheric reentry. And here the outcome of the test flight was much more uncertain. And that's because Starship had to perform reentry with fewer heat shield tiles. For Flight 6, SpaceX wanted to push the envelope of what Starship can endure during reentry. The most obvious change to previous flights was that hundreds of heat shield tiles were removed. You can clearly see the mounting hardware with all the pins poking out of the side of Starship. Aside from seeing how far they can push the vehicle, SpaceX needs to figure out where to mount the hardware to catch Starship later when they want to return it to the launch tower, just as they did with the booster. Having more stainless steel surface available to do so will increase the options, so less heat shield tiles in this case means more. The only parts that were strengthened were the hinges of the flaps, since those had experienced the most damage in a previous flight. And we did indeed see another instance of re-entry heat burning through the flap, but just a tip this time. Nevertheless, Starship managed to survive the sequence of the flight and we were able to see it in all its glory thanks to a daylight re-entry. Starship re-entering the atmosphere has always been an amazing spectacle. But this time we were treated to a couple of new angles, for instance looking straight out of the engine bay. While still in orbit, we saw ice building up at this pipe, almost turning it into a crystalline flower. This of course melted away when things heated up during re-entry. We also saw a broad spectrum of colors and the Indian Ocean in the background while Starship screamed through the atmosphere. The images were pretty amazing and were consistently broadcast via SpaceX's own Starlink satellite communications network. If you remember re-entry phases of old, there was always a blackout happening due to plasma buildup. Thanks to Starlink, engineers are able to watch what's really going on with their vehicle instead of guessing. One of the things that was notable after Starship had come through the re-entry process was the discoloration of the stainless steel hull, almost giving it an oil slick-like pattern. There was also a moment where a heat shield tile fell off and crashed into the aft flap. Luckily for Starship, that didn't impact the flap's performance because it needed it to do the nosedive. If you remember how Starship performed its landing maneuvers, you will know that it usually does a belly flop, basically in full flat horizontal position, bleeding off as much velocity as it can before it reignites its engines to do a flip and braking burn maneuver to touch down softly. This time, however, SpaceX had programmed the vehicle to do a bit of a nosedive to test out what happens when Starship flies at a more aggressive angle of attack. The idea behind that was to see how the equipment would behave for future missions when they maybe want to use this type of maneuver to fly the spacecraft closer to the launch tower using aerodynamics rather than rocket propulsion. While the nosedive was just performed for a short while, SpaceX celebrated it as a success before Starship resumed its belly flop position and then landed softly in the Indian Ocean. This time we got to see footage from the buoy cameras showing how Starship fell over and broke apart. But just like the Super Heavy booster, it did not sink immediately. Instead, it floated for a while, at least until the cameras in SpaceX's livestream cut away. And with that, the sixth test flight for Starship was over. While there was no spectacular tower catch to behold, and some media outlets made a big deal out of that, the mission can still be counted as a success. Mainly, as I said above, because Starship demonstrated its capability to deorbit itself or perform other maneuvers in the future. Upcoming missions will probably go for one or two stable orbits before they will start deorbiting the vehicle and bring it down, maybe this time closer to Starbase in Boca Chica, Texas. I hope you enjoyed this little summary of Flight 6, and if you want to support what I do on this channel, you can sign up to be a YouTube member or hop on over on Patreon and support me there. Depending on the tier you select, your name will show up here together with all of these wonderful folks. Thank you so much for your support. Will Starship be flying to Mars in 2026? What do you think what we're going to see with the next test flight? Let me know in the comments below. Oh, and also, what has happened to the banana? We need to know.
If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe to my channel for more and follow me on my social thingies. The links are in the description. Thanks for watching. Goodbye.